When I'm not talking about the brain, I'm working with senior executives from many large organizations and many technical people. I find my day job is kind of translating what might be thought of as soft skills for a technical audience to understand how to optimize, you know, processing. So that's enough about me. I want to talk about these four surprises. The rational is overrated, massively overrated. The emotions, we've got emotions backward, social issues are primary, literally primary, and attention actually changes the brain. We're going to spend most time on the first and second and a bit on the third. I'm going to stop after each and see if you have questions or comments. And if I go too fast, you can slow me down. If you want me to speed up, it's Google, I can speed up as well, just take, you know, get to the point. We can do whatever you like. All right, the rational is overrated. What do I mean by that? Let's do give you a little metaphor. When you're trying to hold information in mind, you're trying to actually hold information, you're going to start using your prefrontal cortex, PFC for short. I shorten it so it takes less space in your PFC. When you try to hold information in mind, which is to understand, decide, recall, memorize, inhibit, when you try to do that, you've got to use your prefrontal cortex, which is a very limited region of the brain. You know, those of you who drove to work today, you didn't really use your prefrontal cortex to drive here. You're using deeper regions that you can use without thinking. Like, you know, you can drive with without having to think about where you're going if you've gone somewhere a lot. If you're actually consciously thinking, you've got to use your prefrontal cortex. And this is where the trouble begins. Let me do a little experiment. What's call an answer out. What's 1 plus 1? No prefrontal cortex, right? No effort. What's 10 plus 10? No prefrontal cortex. What's 56 plus 175? Laughter. No one wants to do it. Okay. Do you get that? Why don't you want to do it? Why don't you want to do it? Because you've got to put in a bit of effort. You've got to actually stop other things you might be thinking about, because when you use this process, it becomes a serial process. You can do one thing at a time. And you've got to use effort. And did you sense like a little bit of like a, uh-oh, don't take me there, like I'm not going there? It's a subtle threat. The reason it's a subtle threat to have to think is we evolved at a time when resources, metabolic resources, were really limited. You know, war and famine, we lived to 20 at best. And so we're kind of rewarded for minimizing mental resources. You know, it's very easy in this country in particular to make an absolute fortune basically helping people, you know, put in less and less effort into any particular thing. Have you noticed that? It's very difficult to kind of do the opposite. And in many ways, Google exists because it helps people find things with less effort as well. Okay, and you know, can measure that in milliseconds. So using this cortex when you have to, you know, do an addition, we sort of avoid it. We go, I don't really want to do that. It's a threat response, and that threat response does something. So we kind of don't do it very much. And this is a bit of a challenge. Now let me give you the metaphor to understand it. If the amount of information you can hold in your prefrontal cortex at one time, sometimes it's called working memory and it has other titles, but if the amount of information you can hold in this region is equivalent to, say, a cubic foot, okay, a cubic foot, then the amount of information that the rest of your brain holds is equivalent to about the Milky Way. So they're kind of different, you get that sense, right? It's a little disambiguous to say it, but they're really massively different. And this explains a tremendous number of life's experiences, because what we do is we firstly try to avoid using this region of the brain. We do things that we know how to do well rather than doing something differently. And anything that we do a few times, we quickly start to embed the pattern so we don't have to think about it. And essentially, when you're trying to make someone think, like trying to change a pattern or change a system or install some software or do anything, you know, you're going to get this threat response because people are, you know, going to have to think, and we, you know, they're attuned not to. So it explains a tremendous amount. But this rational resource is what people put so much kind of credence into. You know, it's like, you know, we've really got to be rational, and Spock was all about really being deeply rational. It turns out the rational is really, really overrated, and it's overrated in two ways. Firstly, what you can do with it. And secondly, it's actually not how we solve most problems. The rational is not how we solve most problems, which I'll come back to. But there's some studies showing that every time you do a little math puzzle like that, or any conscious decision, you actually use up a limited bucket of resources. Every time you make a decision, solve a problem, your blood glucose goes down, and your performance on the next task goes down. So it's really a limited resource that depletes very quickly. And you can actually start to look at this and sort of pull apart three types of thinking that we do. and start to treat this resource of your prefrontal resource as something that you've got to kind of manage. So, you know, level one thinking is basically stuff like 1+1. You know, you don't have to think. And isn't it fun deleting emails? Does anyone else get joy deleting emails? It's wonderful, isn't it? It's like, ah, you know, I fly a lot, and one of the things I love to do when I'm flying, if I really can't do anything else, is delete. And one time, I was on a long flight, I saw the bottom of my email inbox. Isn't that incredible? It's just like never happens, you know? Anyway, so you can do that without thinking. Level two, scheduling a meeting. You've got to hold things in mind. What time, where, who, when? Maybe 5 seconds, 10 seconds. What about writing a pitch, writing some coding? Building a plan, building a strategy, that takes a lot of glucose and it takes a lot of effort and energy. Now, what many people do, they get to work, they do number one and then number two first, and then they've got very little energy left for number three. And their brain actually becomes tired and noisy. And I'll talk about the noisy in a moment. And they become really, really ineffective. So the sort of intuitive approach that we have to, you know, tackling our day is wrong from the brain's perspective. So this is one of the first things. The rational is overrated. It would be really rational to get to work, start working on emails, and, you know, work through. That's really rational. It's not how your brain really wants to work. Now, there's kind of a question that I pose to people often, and it's sort of one of the questions in the book, which is, you know, if you truly respected attention as a limited resource, what would you do differently? If you really accepted that you've probably only got a few hours of really quality deep processing time, level three activity, what would you do differently if you really like thought about that? And it's quite an important conversation to have, I believe, in an organization that's processing a lot mentally. Now, here's the challenge though. Most problems we solve are not solved rationally. And in the lab, we see that the PFC not only isn't the source of the solution, but is actually the source of not finding the solution. The prefrontal cortex, rational resources, actually stop you solving problems a lot of the time. And in the lab, we see that about 60% of problems that people solve, they actually can't explain how they solve them. It's just, you have that experience all the time. You know, you're walking to work and suddenly you get an idea. Where did that idea come from? You weren't working on anything. Where did it come from? You know, you're in the shower, you're on the treadmill, you're doing something, and suddenly you have this answer coming to you. Why couldn't you have that when you wanted to? You know that feeling? Why couldn't you have solved that problem where you went? Well, you can if you understand your brain a bit better. And it turns out that the very thing that you normally use to solve problems is the inhibitor of solutions if the problems are complex. It's the inhibitor. Your prefrontal cortex is the inhibitor. And there's a whole framework around this that I won't go into too far, but there's a study of insight now. About the last 5 years, there's been a study of insight. And this was published in my last book that a few people here have been reading called Quiet Leadership. And you can actually now understand how insights occur. And I'll give you just the cliff notes, kind of the most valuable piece. And that is that in order for insight to happen, you actually have to stop thinking. You have to stop any form of conscious, mental, deliberate process to have these insights. And there's a couple of complex reasons for that. But let me give you a demonstration of it first. And let's see kind of how you go with this. This is a simple puzzle. You've basically got five words there. Time flies like an arrow. And it normally means time moves swiftly in one direction. You know, time goes straight ahead, time goes forward. Can anyone think of a different interpretation of those five words? Like quite a substantially different interpretation. Anyone think of one over here?
If you are keeping track of flies, and you're trying to time them, you should time them the same way that you time.
Very good. Okay, so that was a record for that answer. So you guys have very good hiring processes because people never get so quickly to an answer like that. Anyone else get one? Yeah, over here. Very good. Okay, anyone else get one? Absolutely. So what does it require to come up with these different solutions? What does it require mentally? You've got to kind of dampen down this solution in your brain. You've got to consciously, and it's pretty easy to do with just five words, much harder to do with a complex project. But you've got to actually dampen down the existing solution and go, I'm going to think about this fresh. I'm going to unlock, you know, the word time in the sort of structure it is, in the sentence structure. I'm going to reimagine it. Okay, and I'll give you five of them. Check the speed of flies the way you would time an arrow. Check the speed of flies only if they're similar to an arrow. Check the speed of flies the way an arrow would. And my favorite, time flies, a type of fly, are fond of arrows, which you got. And there's some more if you get subtle, but many people have tremendous difficulty with this because they're not experienced at dampening down their own thinking, and clearly you guys have developed great cognitive control. You know when it's time to kind of stop thinking one way and try thinking another way. It's a very, very important capacity for maximizing internal processing. So insight involves stopping thinking about the problem and allowing a completely different solution to come through. And this is a summary of Mark Beeman's research on insight. And they see an alpha wave, which is, you can see the purple line up there. The alpha wave is the brain going into idle just for a couple of seconds. The good news is it's not 2 months, it's 2 seconds. But when you put the brain into idle, it's like putting a car into neutral and things just kind of can come through. The basic science of this is a little complex to explain in a short time, but essentially a thought, like if I say picture an elephant, that's going to be a connection between millions if not billions of neurons, and the electrical activity given